hard-hitting news. Alternative Talk Radio. Get ready, America, for Deadline Live with your host, Jack Blood. Deadline Live is the daily wrap-up for those too busy in the daily grind to discern and dissect the news. While the so-called mainstream media buries the truth, Jack Blood uncovers it, exposing the lies that our trusted government officials do not want us to know. And now, please welcome Jack Blood.
Exposing the lies, the disinformation, the war propaganda, and the social engineering that your trusted government officials do not want you to know about. Welcome, fellow thought criminals and enemies of the state. This is Deadline Live, the fourth day of January 2011. I'm Jack Blood, your narrator, your radio gun, reporting for the next 2 hours. Allegedly, we will be joined by F. William Engdahl here in just a few minutes on the show. He is just a massive resource out there. Has been for many, many years, writing about the economy, writing about geopolitics, and lately writing about WikiLeaks. One of the big stories at DeadlineLive.info since we put it up, the big government con job that could be WikiLeaks. We'll explore that and a lot more. That is, if we can connect with Germany and F. William Engdahl here in just a few minutes on the show, and then we may have a special guest in the second hour. We're working hard for you. Could be related to this. Mass Louisiana bird deaths puzzle investigators. Or do they? Are they really puzzled? If you read the body of the story, first we'll give you the story. Hundreds of dead and dying birds littered a quarter-mile stretch of highway in Pointe Coupe Parish this Monday as motorists drove over them and around them. State biologists are trying to determine what led to the deaths of the estimated 500 red-winged blackbirds and starlings in Louisiana. Just down the road from Pointe Coupe Central High School. The discovery of the dead birds, some of which were lying face down, clumped in groups, while others were face up with their wings outstretched and rigid legs pointing upward, comes just 3 days after more than 3,000 blackbirds rained down from the sky in Beebe, Arkansas. And last couple of days, we've been talking about both chemtrails and these bird deaths, and I realize really what we're saying to you here. Yeah, the sky is falling. Literally, in the case of chemtrails. Well, they did some autopsies. Necropsies. I don't know. There's a new word I learn every day here on this show. necropsies. Autopsies on the little birdies from Arkansas. It showed that, and this just confirms the working theory of your loving government of the EPA, who is right now trying to pass various legislation. They suffered internal injuries that formed blood clots leading to their deaths. In other words, they got confused in a storm and flew into each other. The events take place, says the article, it's not terribly unusual. Bird deaths in Canada. I guess it's not these days. Bird deaths in Arkansas, bird deaths in Louisiana. The canary in the coal mine. A lot more news to report on the show today. And William Engdahl, hopefully, right up to this. Stay tuned. To the people, not the government. Got to take that power back, America, the rest of the world. Thank you for joining us. Deadline Live. I'm Jack Blood, your narrator, your radio gun, as always. And yes, we are live today. It is the fourth day of January 2011. Welcome to the new year. We're starting it off with a bang. Joining us on the air from Germany is F. William Engdahl. He is an American by pedigree, grew up in Texas, born in Minnesota, highly studied. One of his first books, The Century of War, Anglo-American Oil Politics and the New World Order, discusses the alleged roles of Zbigniew Brzezinski and George Ball and of the USA and the 1979 overthrow of the Shah of Iran, which he says was meant to manipulate oil prices and stop Soviet expansion. I guess we could say in that way it worked. How did they do it? Balkanization. Look around you. In 2007, he completed his book, Seeds of Destruction, The Hidden Agenda of GMO, something we talk about on the show all the time. His latest book is Gods of Money, Wall Street and the Death of the American Century by William Engdahl, who has also written a great new story that we have posted at deadlinelive.info discussing the very complicated issue of WikiLeaks. Who are they, and is this just a big government con job? F. William Engdahl joins us. Thank you so much, William. Appreciate you being on the show today.
Well, I'm glad to be with you, Jack.
You sound really good from Germany, which I'm also very pleased with. I've gotten a lot of crap for this, for not just accepting that WikiLeaks is everything we're being told in the mainstream media and getting down on my knees and kissing the hem of Julian Assange's hem. I don't like not being on the bandwagon, William. I don't know about you, but sometimes you just got to look at something, and if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck and poops like a duck, it's a duck. Give us kind of your rundown on why you're very suspicious of this organization and maybe what they're trying to accomplish here.
Well, organization seems a little bit far stretched right now because it seems to be a giant, brilliantly orchestrated publicity operation for the marketing of Julian Assange, this 39-year-old Australian who seems to have a talent for jumping from Sweden to London to Lord knows where to Iceland and so forth. Always one step ahead of everybody, and then portrays himself as this gallant figure who's out to rip the covers off of government secrecy worldwide, especially the U.S. government, and expose the nefarious doings. Well, in fact, what's being exposed is being exposed by some of the top people in the U.S. establishment. I'm thinking of David Sanger at the New York Times, who Assange gave the responsibility to leak the so-called 250,000 pages of the State Department cables and so forth. But the whole story, WikiLeaks, stinks from top to bottom at this point, not even addressing the fact that many of the founding people around Assange have left in disgust over the last months at the way this thing is playing itself out. But if you put everything together and just pose a hypothesis from afar, this stinks of an intelligence operation, a disinformation operation. And who would be behind such a thing? Well, it would suit the U.S. Intelligence community to a T, because after all, you have a guy, David Sanger at the New York Times, is a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, which is not exactly anti-establishment. It is the establishment, in fact. He's also a member of an Aspen Institute policy group, which numbers Condoleezza Rice and former heads of the CIA among his fellow colleagues. So this guy is not leaking anything damaging to the U.S. He even wrote that it shows how hardworking and diligent American Foreign Service officers are doing their job around the world. But what you have is the potential now through this incredible myth about the Assange WikiLeaks thing, that U.S. intelligence and State Department can leak anything they want about any government in the world, and who could say that this wasn't true? They just can invent these cables. Also, if I can take a minute to close out on this, this young kid Manning, this 22-year-old who supposedly sat there with rewritable Lady Gaga DVDs in Baghdad over a period of 8 months and fooled all his colleagues and just walked off with 250,000 pages of security classified government documents to be dumped on the internet. Well, computer experts in the United States who know exactly what and have consulted with the Pentagon on these security systems says you would not be able to download the first byte without being detected by a data center operations security officer and alarms going off worldwide. So the idea that he could do this with impunity, pretending to listen to Lady Gaga for 8 months, is just a joke.
Well, it does kind of play into this kind of coincidence theory that we get by conspiracy debunkers who refuse to believe that there can ever be a conspiracy because, you know, the government is, they're just incompetent and they don't know how to stop this. They don't have any hackers of their own, William, and they don't know how to stop
this. No, they don't. The Pentagon, the hackers exist for the Pentagon to hire them to run operations on the, you know, on enemy target websites, whether it's China, whether it's Russia, who knows what, Germany and so forth. So, you know, you establish your reputation as a hacker and you're guaranteed to be a Pentagon consultant or a CIA consultant. So there's no mystery about that.
Well, I mean, and there's a certain amount. This is what kind of set off a lot of red flags for me, William. And we're with William Engdahl today. We'll tell you more about how to get a hold of him. If you've been living in a cave in Afghanistan somewhere and hadn't heard of him or read all of his great books and writing over all the years, we'll get you up to speed on that. You know, the thing with me is, you know, I just see all this as war propaganda. I mean, you hear that all of a sudden it's been confirmed. I mean, this is literally John Bolton could be Julian Assange. This is the most hawkish, neoconish war propaganda coming out and giving us all the dirt we needed to know on the axis of evil and other evils out there, of course. And this is where it does seem a little suspicious that there doesn't seem to be any anything on Israel. Israel didn't do anything wrong, and they never got wrapped up in any of these cables, which has, as you know, led people to believe that this could be some kind of a Mossad combination operation. I know we're not supposed to say that because it sounds like we hate Jews, but really, that is just a glaring coincidence. Nobody benefits more from this than Israel, and as my friend Wayne Madsen says, George Soros.
Well, I think Soros is involved in funding this in some way or another, the WikiLeaks thing, but that I don't have the concretes on in front of me. But whether it's Israeli intelligence and the U.S. intelligence working in tandem or whether it's simply the U.S. doing this, I think the point is the same.
Yeah.
The strategic agenda of the current Israeli government and the current U.S. government is one and the same, with a few nuances of difference, but very, very few. And I think the point is that the U.S. power establishment, the Pentagon military industry complex, have one agenda. They call it full-spectrum dominance. And that is to, as Brzezinski said in his famous book, 1997, about the Grand Chess Game, the only power combination potentially on the face of the earth that could threaten American domination is Eurasia, which means China, Russia, and the countries in between, including Iran and other Middle East oil countries. And if they come together, they have the population necessary, they have the raw materials necessary, they have the military know-how necessary, especially Russia. And China is moving to catch up and fill the gap as rapidly as possible, but they still have probably a decade or two more to do it. And that has to be prevented at all costs. If you look at U.S. geopolitics at the end of the Cold War in 1990-91, or 89 if you count the fall of the wall in Berlin, the Cold War never ended for the Pentagon. The Cold War simply took on a different guise and became reborn in 2001 September as the war on terror or the war against Islam or the war on whoever we say is our enemy under every bed and under every
You got to have an Emmanuel Goldstein when you're talking about Eurasia being at war with Oceania. That all rings, it's a little scary. Yep. All of this was in 1984, and as we know, he was a Fabian socialist,
George Orwell,
And he, as well as Huxley, they had, you know, these really good connections to kind of put this stuff down into a fictional representation of what was really going on in the world, because you couldn't just print this stuff. You weren't allowed to do that, especially if you were on the inside. So I guess they weren't psychics. They knew.
I think my take on 1984, I reread it recently, and it's absolutely brilliant, is he was describing the British intelligence operations to create this post-war control society and whitewashing it as the Soviet-Stalin system. But in fact, he was talking about firsthand knowledge of what the British intelligence, the Tavistock Institute, and some of these organizations were doing in Britain and in the U.S. after the war.
Also, going back to WikiLeaks and Julian Assange, as you write in your article, you know, this is a guy that believes the government version of 9/11. He thinks the Bilderberg Group is a normal meeting of people, and it's not, you know, there's nothing bad going on there. I mean, he really just is a mockingbird, a repeater for the New World Order. And so this is what surprises me. A, why is everybody falling for it? I mean, people that I work with for years that seem to have their eyes open and to be, you know, somewhat awake, they're just lapping this up, William. And I'm, of course, catching a lot of crap for it. In fact, maybe this has happened to you. I'm chalking it down as a coincidence. But as soon as I started,
I started
heavily criticizing WikiLeaks, and all my computers went down and were broken in a way that I've never seen before. All my websites were hacked, and I don't know. I mean, I have to suspect a group of hackers here.
Yeah. Well, I'll just give you an idea. The one of my publishers put a link to my articles on Something Stinks About WikiLeaks, and then the newest one, WikiLeaks, a big dangerous U.S. government con job, as an example, in a very neutral tone, he put it as an example of one of the critique articles about the WikiLeaks operation onto Wikipedia under WikiLeaks, and within 2 hours it had been deleted. So it just, this is very highly monitored. And the image that these are a bunch of freelancing kids out there who are clever with computers and hacking and so forth, that's just a myth for the credulous, to my mind. This is an intelligence operation.
What you're really saying is I am, and you are, we are going at and blowing apart this propaganda scheme. And it isn't some little hacker at WikiLeaks that's messing with us. It's the government themselves.
Well, that certainly seems to be the strong indication.
I've never seen anything like it. I had one my production computer go down, which is a whole different IP than the one that was already attacked. And now I'm sitting here. I had two computers, and now I have a half a computer. But that that hasn't stopped me, William, as you can see.
Well, that's good.
I also interviewed John Young, who was one of the founders of WikiLeaks at Cryptomi, and he doesn't care for these guys at all. He doesn't believe that many of the cables or many of the documents are even real. In fact, a wholesale made up is what he might suspect, and on some levels, and that these people are easily usable egomaniacs, and they're being used even if they don't know they're being used. And we had explored some of the connections, such as the Open Society Institute and any number of front organizations from the Soros gang into this, and Madsen again coming out saying this could be Soros's cyber hit gang. I mean, look at it like this, and we can get in economics and geopolitics in this now, too, because the attack, just the rumor that there would be attack or there would be some kind of a revealing document talking about the foul play at Bank of America, sent the stock spiraling. And again, if anyone had inside knowledge that was coming out and that they were going to be attacked and did a little hedging on that, as Soros is known to do, they could have lined their pockets and also be attacking the enemies. Notice that Chase Manhattan doesn't have any cables coming out about them.
Yeah, J.P. Morgan Chase. Or Goldman Sachs, or a few of the others that are the golden boys of Wall Street. I call them in my new book, The Gods of Money. But, that's the dangerous. That's why I call it a dangerous U.S. government con job. The danger is once you have a broad general public credibility of this, and each country, you sit here in Germany and all of the German talk shows, they love talk shows in this country, all of the talk shows were just obsessed with the intimate details of an aide to the foreign minister who had lunch with the U.S. ambassador or secretary in the embassy and was a little bit too talkative about certain things that were going on in internal party discussion and whether he should be fired or not and so forth. So the whole thing takes on this credibility, and that gives you the broad context to leak anything you want to in a spiked way. As Brzezinski even said this. This is he all but said this is an intelligence operation where you have a huge amount of innocuous documents that seem to be credible and rather boring in terms of content. And then within that, you can spike however you want. If you want to spike something that creates a friction between North Korea and South Korea and brings the situation to the brink of war that would involve China and so forth and destabilize China through that, you know, you've got the potential to do that. The same thing with Iran, where Hillary Clinton said the WikiLeaks revelations are good in the sense they show that we have the right policy in isolating Iran and so forth. And so it doesn't show anything. It's just, you know, I have to laugh when I read the WikiLeaks on description of the U.S. embassy in Moscow about Medvedev and Putin, the president and prime minister in Russia. They said this is the Batman and Robin. I said this tells more about the cultural level of the U.S. diplomatic corps nowadays than it does anything about the the president and prime minister of Russia.
Well, and another kind of moniker here of a government operation is the cost-benefit analysis and how they are able to use this WikiLeaks, quote-unquote, to benefit on multiple levels. And this came right after Senate Bill 773, the Cybersecurity Act. I call security
right.
control, so it's Cyber Control Act of 2009. You've got the FCC trying to help us and legislate the Internet, of course, Senate Bill 773, put up by Jay Rockefeller, the good guy down there in West Virginia, just a good Democrat.
Good old boy, just a good old country boy down there in West Virginia.
Plays right into his hands. And we've done a story a couple of years ago noticing that we believe that the Internet Patriot Act is already written and all they need is a new, quote, Internet Pearl Harbor to set it off and put it into motion.
Well, this is setting the stage for it as well, as I point out in the article.
Oh, boy. Can they get a new playbook? Can they dust off that old playbook, William, and at least give us the benefit, the respect to try something new?
Well, that's the point. At this point, I think they're running on automatic pilot. And said in my newest book, The Gods of Money, The Wall Street and the Death of the American Century, American Century was a term that was given by Henry Luce, a member of the inner circles of the establishment in 1941 to describe 100 years of America dominating the world. But he wasn't talking about American democracy. He was talking about an American empire that didn't call itself that. And that is what is really in its death throes since you have this explosion of the securitization subprime real estate debacle in 2007. And, you know, the onset of a new Great Depression, not a recession, but a Great Depression that's going to be horrendous for the American people over the next 10 to 15 years, by my estimate. And in that context, I think largely what the elites and the Pentagon machines and so forth, after all, they're a product of a culture. And if the culture is dying or being systematically destroyed by the dumbing down that these elites have put into the education system and so forth, their generals, their spooks and so forth are all going to be dumbed down along with it. And I think they're just operating on automatic pilot at this point. They don't know how to do anything differently. They don't know how to think differently. I've met countless people from the ranks of the establishment, political and business and financial, and over the years. And, they're very, for the most part, frighteningly shallow people.
Yeah. Well, I mean, look, they're using the old playbook. They might be on automatic pilot, but as long as we're not on automatic pilot.
that's the point.
Yeah. I posted a story.
People are willing to think and take responsibility for their own affairs, for their own lives and their families. Then it becomes a different ballgame. But that's why the passivity is so essential to this to this game plan. I think the idea of instilling fear
of a Tea Party and to channel all your anger through a Tea Party and then go home and go back to sleep. I posted this story today, which I think really encompasses everything we're talking about, William. I call it the New World Order Shuffle. Chicago switcheroos. Do you know that Rahm Emanuel has gone to Chicago to be mayor of Chicago? And the mayor's brother, Dick Daley's brother, Bill, he's going to go take the old handling job of handling Obama as the chief of staff. They just switched places.
Switched roles.
But then the people won't hold them accountable for everything they did as chief of staff because now they're mayor of Chicago. And now they're not mayor of Chicago or former secretary of agriculture, because you know all about this. Bill Daley, but now he'll be overseeing the president, the alleged president, as we call him here. Yes. Jim Engdahl is with us. We'll tell you more about his work, his books, his website, and how to support his work. Stay with us. Deadline Live, I'm Jack Blood. This is Oracle Broadcasting and Affiliates. We'll be right back. That's right. Well, I guess we're the fly in the ointment. Thanks for joining us. Deadline Live, Oracle Broadcasting, and affiliates, deadlinelive.info. I'm Jack Blood, your radio gun, as always. F. William Engdahl joins us on the air today from Germany, staying up late with us. He's got a great new book out. It just came out last year, Gods of Money, Wall Street and the Death of the American Century. That follows full-spectrum dominance, totalitarian democracy in the New World Order, and Seeds of Destruction. Many of you have read or, check that out a little bit. That's the hidden agenda of GMO. And then his first book that I know of, A Century of War, Anglo-American Oil Politics and the New World Order. We are in perpetual war. William Engdahl, I have a website for you, engdahl.oilgeopolitics.net, and you write extensively for globalresearch.ca, one of our favorite websites. Any other websites you want to plug where we can get your books and find out more about you?
Well, the books are generally available through an arrangement with Amazon, so that's the easiest way to get them, or directly through my website, oilgeopolitics.net, engdahloilgeopolitics.net.
There you go. And our good friends at BraveNewBookstore.com have your books as well. And well, that helps out one of our sponsors and good Americans here in Texas.
Okay.
So everybody gets in on it. That's how I like to see it. Because I really think you have a lot to say, and I hope that this is only the first of many interviews we'll get to do with you. There is a lot going on in the world, and some of it I want you to help us chop through, if you could, William. Right now, oil is in play big time. We've done a lot of homework on this. Jim Norman's The Oil Card, I thought, was very helpful for us to understanding the economic hitmen working out there, using oil as an economic weapon. Caught between that is China and Russia, Venezuela, Iran. This is a very tricky little way to kind of punish people who you don't like. And if you can give us your breakdown on all of that, I'd appreciate it.
Well, I'm finishing a new book, which will probably be out in the late spring, early summer, in English, called The New Energy Wars, provisional title. And it goes through the much of the time span of the Century of War book, which, by the way, will be coming out in a new edition finally after a hiatus of several months in getting the rights back from the London publisher, but I'll be bringing that out in February of this coming year for anyone who's following that. But the point about the oil wars is that it goes back to a comment attributed to Henry Kissinger when he was Secretary of State and essentially running the Nixon administration back in the mid-70s. You control the oil, you control entire nations. And the U.S., since the Navy went off coal-fired ships to oil-fired ships around the time of World War One, the Rockefeller family built a power basis around oil as the era of petroleum, was fostered. And for the last century and a quarter, the control of oil has been the governor, if you will, in the sense of a governor on a lawnmower engine. The governor to control the entire world economy in a major way. So if you control the energy throughput of that economy by raising the price of oil, by collapsing the price of oil, by restricting the availability of oil through the myth of peak oil. There is no peak oil. There's so much oil deep in the core of the earth under the mantle that we can go for thousands of years by the estimates of some geophysicists who've gone deeply into this question. But that's a subject for a whole other...
We've done that show. We've done that show many times. William, I'm with you on that. Yeah.
Yeah. But in any case, the point is you've got to keep the myth of peak oil going. The oil companies do. Dick Cheney does. His late departed friend Matt Simmons was a consultant on the Cheney Energy Task Force. So that tells you about his credibility in terms of his alliance with big oil and Halliburton. But the point is this is all about geopolitics, to control through balance of power games, through divide and conquer manipulations and so forth. You bring down the Soviet Union by making them first dependent on the dollar flows of oil exports back in the late 70s, early 80s. And then in 1986, there was a meeting by Father George H.W. Bush and George Shultz, then Secretary of State, and several key people, the head of the CIA and others. And they said, we have to get Saudi Arabia to turn on the oil spigot and just collapse the price of world oil. Well, they brought oil down from the mid-20s within a matter of months down to $9 and less a barrel. And that, according to Russians that I spoke with after the collapse of the Soviet Union, that was the straw that broke the camel's back along with the whole Star Wars thing of Reagan. And it just financially bankrupted Russia's war machine, so they couldn't finance weapons acquisitions to keep up with the Reagan military spending. That's one example. The other one is when the oil price was manipulated by Goldman Sachs and BP and others through the ICE Futures Exchange in London and the NYMEX and whatnot, through paper oil derivatives. Futures in oil are what decides the physical price of oil today and not physical supply and demand. Anyone who tells you the supply and demand of oils suggests such and such a price is showing their ignorance.
It is a little ignorant.
So, yeah. So these manipulations are it's very, very seamless, sophisticated machine that's been built up. In fact, it's the same machine that they want to run in the cap and trade carbon credit scam through this global warming nonsense that Obama is trying to
push. Oil exists. I mean, carbon derivatives is based on something that doesn't even exist. And I got to tell you, William, our research shows that is already in full gear. It almost seems irreversible. In fact, they're calling carbon offsets the new gold rush. And this is put, if you've seen some of this, you know, they have people in Asia who are trying to irrigate their little fields so that they can feed themselves. And they pedal bicycles now to do that rather than use gas engines, and they receive gold for them, which is a half a carbon credit, which can then be, you know, put on the carbon markets, which are going full steam now, right under our noses, right after the subprime meltdown. Here we have more fake derivatives just being traded and opening things up for even a bigger potential collapse here. And then along with all of that, the polluting companies simply keep polluting and do so by buying entire Agenda 21 set aside areas of forest that we're not allowed to go into, and that gives them all the power to keep polluting. So if you don't like pollution, you're not going to like cap and trade.
No, this whole global warming agenda is a fake, and it has been since Maurice Strong began pushing it through the United Nations 25 or 30 years ago. And he's the one pushing this nonsense in China. He plays on his connections to Anna Louise Strong, his late aunt, who was an advisor to Mao Zedong back in the 50s, to get on the inside track in China. And since he was 17 years old, he's been a protege of David Rockefeller's.
Well, I just look at he is hugely powerful. I think he could be handling China in many ways. And he is a Rockefeller.
Well, he's certainly trying, I'm sure. If he is or not, I've been invited as a guest several times to China around the publication of my books, and I can tell you what I witnessed, and I've given speeches at most of the major universities across the country in China over the last several years, is that there is a critical rethinking of fundamentals of China's relationship to the United States and the rest of the world, and these are not stupid people. They're also not the image that's portrayed in much of the Western media. I've met some lovely friends in China who are some of the most joyful people I've met. A lot of us in the West could well do good in terms of stress reduction by getting to know a little bit of the Chinese methods of singing and in public parks and things like that. But be that as it may, the point is they are figuring out what the New World Order is all about. That's the reason that the Chinese refused to go along with the Copenhagen comm job a year ago in Denmark for the global warming.
At what cost, I guess, we'll have to ask you when we come back. We've got at least one more segment with William Engdahl. Please stay with us. Deadline Live, I'm Jack Blood. Give us 3 minutes. We'll see you then. Thanks for joining us, Deadline Live, Jack Blood. William Engdahl is with us today. Please Google him, check out his work. You can learn a lot by it. And I'm going to warn you, we probably don't agree on some things. I don't know, so far so good, but don't look for people that you have to agree with all the time. Great men and women think for themselves, contrary to popular belief. William Engdahl, you can find him on globalresearch.ca, the great website from Canada. And give me your book again, if you could. I just don't.
Gods of Money, Wall Street, and the Death of the American Century.
That's the one. And I admit I haven't got a chance to read that one yet, and I'm looking forward to doing so, William. So that's right on the top of my list now, and perfect timing. I need another amazing book I can read and then forget, because I have long-term loss of short-term memory. It's a major disability for a talk show host, but we do the best we can. A couple of things real quick. On the economic side of things, people debating here over the debt ceiling. In fact, Austin Goolsbee, who's kind of the Skull and Bones right-hand man of Obama, who followed the Skull and Bones presidency. I know things are changing, folks. You got to love it. He said that the birds that are dying all over America, they died because they hit the debt ceiling. Ha, 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 ha. That's real funny.
Oh, God.
That's the kind of sense of humor Austin Goolsbee has. But you know, a lot of people trying now to stand up against this constant raising of the debt ceiling here. What would be the solution in your mind?
Chapter 11, or for municipalities, it's called Chapter 9, bankruptcy reorganization. It's gone out of control because there's been a coup d'etat, essentially, over the last half a century, actually even longer as I go through in the chronology of the Gods of Money book. But going back to the creation of the Federal Reserve back in 1913, and even before then with the First National Bank, which was majority share-owned by City of London banking interests and not by the U.S. government. But the point is the control over money has been delegated by a corrupt President Woodrow Wilson in 1913, to essentially private banking interests. The Federal Reserve is owned by private banking interests. It's not owned by the U.S. government, as most Americans naively believe. It's owned by private banking interests. The chairman of the Fed, even though there's this puppet show that goes on of the President of the United States naming it, nominating or proposing for approval of the chairman of the Fed, the chairman of the Fed is chosen by the most powerful banks in the country, and those are the Wall Street Gods of Money banks, as I call them. They literally have created a coup d'etat where their interests dominate over the national interests of the United States of America, the interests of the population of the United States of America, the future economic survival of the United States. And it's like a cancer that's simply the Andromeda strain kind of horror scenario that's run amok. And the bailout that both Henry Paulson of Goldman Sachs as Treasury Secretary and Tim Geithner, who's probably going to go to Goldman Sachs when he leaves the Obama administration, have worked out has been at the expense of the American public at a time when the country is being put through the worst depression since the 1930s. Use the D word. Jack, this is not a recession. This is not a recession is over. Shoots of green are popping up and so forth. This is a great depression. These are real families being destroyed, being put out of work, being having their homes repossessed illegally.
Oh, we see it every day. It's been a depression for me since the year 2000 when the bottom really fell out of the economy and I stopped making the good money I was making. And I figured if I'm not going to make a ton of money, I might as well do something important, or I'm trying to do that now. Well, Chapter 11 or Chapter 9, whatever it is, I mean, aren't they devaluing the currency to accomplish the same ends? I don't know, if I believe...
Yeah, well, that's George Soros came out for that in a recent statement a couple of days ago.
Admitting it.
For a long-term, devaluation of the dollar. By doing that, you essentially... wipe out the debt through a form of inflation, but the point is that it's gone into an irreversible process. As long as these pieces of paper, these promises to pay that are called the U.S. dollar, are treated as something real, then the country is going to be destroyed even more than it has been already. The population is going to be destroyed even more than they have been already, and there's no end to it. And then these locust hordes will simply move on to the next victim, which will be China or Germany or Russia or whatever, and that's what's got to be.
Well, I mean, we're getting the same treatment now that people got in Africa and in South America. So
not that unfamiliar. This is the IMF treatment without the IMF.
The riots, the taking over of the resources, we've seen this in their playbook. It's been admitted by some inside in the past. So that brings us to austerity, because one of the predictions we have on this show, and I think it's a fairly good educated position, is that the states are going to start dropping like flies, going broke, and they're going to either need another massive stimulus bailout to increase their police state. That's what they're spending all the money on, William. It's working. Not the infrastructure, not the plumbing, not helping the poor people or bailing people out. They're making a bigger, wider police state, and they're profiting from it. But if that brings us to austerity, is that the end of all of this? The people rioting here in the United States of America, what if anything, would that accomplish? Because I'm looking at Greece and Ireland and everywhere else, and they're going the wrong direction with some of that.
It doesn't accomplish much, as I can see. I don't know of any case where it has accomplished. But the point is, people have to begin thinking again more actively. They have to take anything that I say and write in my books and in my articles and say, well, I don't believe this. It goes against everything I've ever learned. I'm going to find out for myself. That's what I hope people do when I write these provocative things, that they get a splash of cold water in the face and say, wait a minute. There's a 1% chance this guy Engdahl might be on the right track here, but I'm going to check it out for myself and not take his word for it, because I've taken the New York Times word or CNN's word for it all my life, and look where that's brought me.
Well, I wish people thought like that, but what they do is they go from one camp or one mind trap to another, and I'm glad to hear you say, look, I mean, I'm writing this, I've researched it, I believe it, but you go check it out for yourself. We have so little time left. I wanted to get into so many things, so we're just going to have you back. But today it's news in the United States of America that the alleged president cousin, he's cousins with the Bushes, it's cute, he'll be signing Senate Bill 510, the food control bill here. He is the Monsanto president. I mean, you got Vilsack as Secretary of Agriculture. You've got the guys at the food czar at the FDA, Michael Taylor, all these guys coming out of Monsanto. And I don't know how all the hippies that are voting for hope and change can keep going along with this, but they are taking leaps and bounds, these seed barons, right here under our very noses.
Yeah. I'd love to talk about that at some point with you, Jack.
Well, I have a minute left. That's why that was the question I was going to end on.
Oh, okay. Well, the point about this Monsanto takeover of the the whole food industry, this is a project, as I go through in the Seeds of Destruction book. It was started in 1953 with a grant from the Rockefeller Foundation to two professors at Harvard Business School, Ray Goldberg, who's still alive and on the board of several GMO corporations in the United States, and Ike Eisenhower's former assistant agriculture secretary. And they created the Standard Oil model for world food, U.S. food production, now then world food production, of top-down vertical integration. The farmer is the most expendable piece in the food chain. He's to be treated as a serf or as some kind of contract laborer, and drive his prices as low as humanly possible. and industrialize this whole process. The end result of that is the American people are being fed fake food. It's killing them. It's making them sick. It's
exactly what I wrote down here. Fake food. That's what it is. Yeah.
And you know, it's destroying our children, grandchildren, and many of us. If we're
they'll own all the food. They'll own the seeds. They'll have patented all the food, and with their weather machines, they'll be able to control who gets to grow food or have water. I mean, you said oil is a weapon, and food and water is certainly a weapon.
Well, food was the second comment of history. Control the food, you control the people. So it's food for thought. That's what Guy is selected in my book.
William Engdahl, let me get you out of here. The new book, Gods of Money, Wall Street, and the Death of the American Century. Go get it. Go check him out and go to his website. Can't wait to have you back again, William. Best to you. Happy New Year.
Jack, thank you. I'm good.
All right, folks. We'll be right back. Second hour coming up right after this. Deadline Live, Oracle Broadcasting. Stay with us.